We have already observed the chain of inclusions. Natural numbers are sitting inside integers. Integers are sitting inside rationals, and rationals finally set up in real number system. While observing the real number system, we have also seen how much important the set of natural numbers are. So, a set of natural numbers n, we are denoting it by 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. And that is very, it's having many or possessing many nice inbuilt properties. For example, ordering is highly important, the less than. The order less than actually gives a lot of insight in n. One of very fundamental property of natural numbers come from this. So we will just state it as well ordering property or principle of n. It says you take any non-empty subset, it is always having a least element. So well ordering properties of n is nothing other than that. Just take any non-empty subset S of n, then this S is always having a least element. So what is meant by a least element? It simply says the following: there exists some m in n, m in s, such that m is going to be less than or equal to k for every k in s. That is what's the meaning of least element. So any non-empty subset always possess a least element. So this inbuilt order actually guarantees that. So if you are assuming this well-ordering property, we can just transit to very nice fundamental theorems, especially the most celebrated one, the PMI, Principle of Mathematical Induction. We are using Principle of Mathematical Induction as a tool of proof. If you want to prove some properties, which basically comes out as a formulae also, such things, we are making it use of PMIs as a tool. But how to prove PMI? I mean, Principle of Mathematical Induction. Let us try to prove that using this well-ordering property. So we will state what is PMI. You take any subset S of n. If it's having two properties, if it satisfies two properties, that is the beginner of natural number, one is available in S. Moreover, take any natural number k, if you are sure that k is available in S, then it guarantees k plus 1 is also inside S. These two hypotheses, if you are assuming with a subset S of n, then it guarantees that S is not a proper subset. S is going to be the full of N. That is what the basic idea of Principle of Mathematical Induction. Any subset S which take care of 1, moreover any k is available, k plus 1 is also inside S, this inclusion is also guaranteed, then such a set should be the full of natural numbers. How to go along with the proof? Suppose not, S is not equal to N. It says what? N minus S is non-empty. That is the first assumption. So if you are assuming on the contrary, N minus S is non-empty. Once it is non-empty means, this is sitting inside natural numbers. So you have a non-empty subset of natural numbers. By the well-ordering property, it has a least element. So this least element for this fellow, let us denote it by M. M is the least element of n minus s. Now see, 1 is available in s. 1 is available in s means it is not available in n minus s, which implies your m is the least element in n minus s. So m should be greater than 1, which in turn gives you m minus 1 is in n. It's a natural number. M is strictly greater than 1, so m minus 1 is a natural number. But m minus 1, is strictly less than m, which implies what? This m minus 1 is not available in n minus s because small m is the least element. So something strictly smaller won't be there. So m minus 1 is not available in n minus s. But if it is not available in n minus s, where it should be? It's a natural number. So it should be in the complement, that is m minus 1 is in s. Now, you can use the second hypothesis also. M minus 1 is available in S. What is the second hypothesis? Says for any K in S, K plus 1 is also guaranteed in S. So apply it for M minus 1. So let me just call this M minus 1 as K. So if I am denoting K as M minus 1, that is available in S. So its successor, what is its successor? K plus 1, that is, which implies K plus 1, which is going to be M, that is available in S. What happens now? An obvious contradiction. Right? For what? For N minus S is not empty. So you'll get a contradiction. And this contradiction proves that S must be coinciding with A. A very systematic proof, which use very simple innocent property, which is well ordering principle. Well ordering principles says that every non-empty subset of N possesses a least element. But we are always using this PMI as a tool, as I mentioned before. So to restate this PMI in that fashion, the idea is this one: S is a subset of N which can satisfies 1 and 2, we ensure that S is N. So instead of this, you can restate it or reformat it. Something like some property about N if you want to prove. Let me write P of N, for example. It stays for some property like that. Then, on natural numbers. Then how to restate this? Something you have to, some, okay, let us state it formally. Formal way of restating is this. You take, look at any statement about N. That is, P of N is going to be a statement about natural numbers. Now, that P of N is going to be true for 1. That is the first equivalence. So P of 1 is a property holds. For 1, P N holds. That is what it says. More than that, any natural number K you take, if PK, P of K is true, the property holds for K, from there you are getting PK of K plus 1 is also true. Property holds for K implies it holds for K plus 1. That is the second hypothesis. Then such a property should prevail everywhere in it. That is the restatement. Actually, one can see the equivalence. So this is another way of, this is the most a surprising way we are proving many, many results about natural numbers, even formally, very nice formally. We are making use of that. So how you are applying these things? If you remember your plus 2 days, the easiest application, let us start with some very familiar example. Suppose you want to sum up the first n terms of natural numbers. Obviously, the first n natural numbers you add together. Everybody knows that. A nice formula exists for this, n into n plus 1 by 2. So where we have met with this PMI at first, in our mathematical life, I hope. So how do you, how to prove this statement? This is a statement about natural numbers. So let us denote by P of n. So P of n here, it stands for the sum of first n natural numbers is going to be n into n plus 1 by 2. So how to proceed? You have to look at what happens for n equals 1. That is P of 1 you have to look at. P of 1, left hand side and right hand side obviously gives the same value. This is obviously 1. This is 1 plus 1 plus 1 by 2. That is 1 again. So it says that P of 1 is true. P of 1 is true. Assume for k. So immediately it gives you the first, for any k natural number, formula holds k into k plus 1 by 2. A moment's thought. What you have to do is clear. Just work with a plus k plus 1 then so you are trying to look at 1 plus 2 plus etc. Already up to k is there, then a k plus 1 also added together, then how the formula look like? You are expecting that k plus 1 into k plus 2 by 2. It is easy to get. Why is it so? Because up to here, you have the formula. You can assume by the second hypothesis, which means this is going to give you k into k plus 1 by 2 is available here. Then obviously a k plus 1 more. That's clear. Now it's clear what you have to do. So this is what is going to come with 2 is coming up here. So k plus 1, if you are taking it out, ideally k plus 1 into k plus 2 divided by 2 easily come out. So once you are assuming P of k, that is Pn for k, n equals k, P k plus 1 is also going to 2, which internally gives this formula is valid for every natural number. So we have a very beautiful proof for this. That is how PMIs are going to be helpful for us. This we have observed long back. Moreover, see the first statement, the equivalent statement, P of 1 is true. It is not necessary that this property, some property holds from 1 onwards. It may hold from some natural number, some stage n naught in n. But from there onwards, this pk implies pk plus 1, p of k plus 1, things will hold for anything greater, any k greater than this n naught. Then from n naught onwards, that property is going to prevail. So that also can be used well. The first few you can avoid, and this can be used in a very fertile manner in that. So just instead of this, one can also revisit our days of plus 2 and look at some more examples. In the prescribed text also, so many good examples are there and exercises are in plenty. At least try to look at this, some of them. For example, the familiar one, 1 square plus 2 square plus etc. plus n square. Remember your formula and try to verify using PMI. But at least some of the problems are really nice that we can't. See, as an application, we can't avoid. So just as a nice application, just look at the following. Suppose I'm asking the question, is 4 is a factor of 11 to the power 8 minus 7 to the power 8? Answer is yes. Because, see, actually this 8 is not very much important. You can work with the 9 or any natural number. So in general, what is going to happen is the following. 11 raised to n minus 7 raised to n. This is always taking 4 as a factor. Which means 4 is always going to divide. I mean, this x stands for divides. 4 is a factor of this part. Use that notation very well. D divides n means D is a, this is the notation. D divides, you have to say. So divides, it means D is a factor of n. So n is a multiple of D. That's what is going to happen. So 4 divides this quantity, 11 to the power n minus 7 raised to n for every n. Why is it so? Is no? Actually, this 11 minus 7 you have to look at. 11 minus 7 is actually 4. That is the only thing what you are aiming at. So the required property is something like this. You take any two real numbers, A and B. Two real numbers are supplied. Now, this is what the precise statement, what you are going to prove it. A minus B is always is a factor of A to the power N minus B to the power N. This is what a very general statement of this kind of applications. For any real numbers A and B, n is any natural number, then A minus B is going to be a factor of A raised to N minus B raised to N. Obviously, A square minus B square contains A minus B, A cubed minus B cubed, and such things are known for us. So once you are proving this, it's just give the N equal to 8, you should get any analogous problems. So how to prove this? A minus B always divides A raised to N minus B raised to N. Let us work with the PMI. That's a very nice example to look. So let me just discuss about that. Some hints, let me make it out. So what is our PN here? The statement is A minus B is going to be a factor, or it divides or a factor of A raised to N minus B raised to N. So how will you check? P of 1, you have to check. Obvious, A minus B will come. So A minus B is always a factor of A minus B. So P of 1 is true. What do you have to assume now? It is true for some K. So assume that. Suppose that P of K is true. K is a natural number. Which says A minus B is a factor of A raised to K minus B raised to K. From there, what you are expecting? A minus B is going to divide A raised to K plus 1 minus B raised to K plus 1. That's what you are expecting. Once you are able to prove that, it holds. This formula holds for every N. So how to prove this? For that, it's very simple. A simple manipulation will give you. Because A raised to K plus 1 minus B raised to K plus 1, you have to look at. Just insert something, the useful thing. So A raised to K plus 1, with that, I'm just taking it out A, B raised to K. So I have to nullify that effect. I can just put there also. Then B raised to K is available with me. Just I have taken out and given that. Now what is the advantage is you rewrite or manipulate it here. So just to take out your A out. So it will be A raised to K minus B raised to K will come in the first side, first term. Second term what I am pulling out is, here it is B raised to K plus 1. So I will just take out B raised to K. Then what remains is A minus B, right? So second term is B raised to K into A minus B. So look at all together. A raised to K plus 1 minus B raised to K plus 1. The right hand side is the sum of two terms. So second term is obviously having A minus B as a factor. First term, A into this fellow. A raised to K minus B raised to K. But our hypothesis says that A minus B always is going to divide A raised to K minus B raised to K. Which means A minus B is a factor of the first term as well as the second term. So for the sum, which says on the RHS, and it turns gives you A minus B is a factor of left hand side also. So that completes the proof for injection for this. So this statement holds for every N. It actually gives that in particular any 8, this problem also can be solved. Some more interesting exercises and examples are supplied in the text. One can look at some of them. I'm just for interest, for the sake of completeness, I'm writing some of them. See here, you look at the first, there is an inequality. 2 raised to n is greater than 2n plus 1. That you are asked to prove. But obviously it's not going to be hold for 1 and 2. N equals 1 and 2. So we have to fix some n naught. That is all. So the beginner was the hypothesis 1 has to be replaced by 3 onwards. That's only they are expecting. So this is holding, this inequality is going to hold for anything greater than or equal to 3. That is what you are trying to do. So how to do that? Again, work with the 3, it holds, then it is P of 3 is true. 1 and K equals 1 and 2, it won't work. Now, assume that it's true for K, P of K. P of K is true. What is P of K true? This inequality holds for K, which means you have this one, 2 raised to K. So we are assuming that this 2 raised to K is 2 raised to K is greater than 2 raised to K plus 1. Now what will you do? Now 2 raised to K plus 1, you rewrite, it is going to be greater than 2 times 2 raised to K. 2 raised to K can be again given to 2 K plus 1. So replace like this. simplify like expand like this. Now rearrange 2k 2k like this. Now observe that 2k plus 2, that is greater than 2k plus 3. Whenever k is greater than or equal to 1, that you can assume here. So once you are getting this, rewrite it is 2k plus 2 plus 1 like that. The 2 can be taken out. So it is in the real format what you are in. Ideally, you will get 2 raised to k plus 1 is greater than 2 times k plus 1 plus 1. So you are going to get this. Remember, we have used an additional fact. 2k plus 2 is greater than 3. That is true for any k greater than or equal to 1. It's clear. So the whole thing will work out in the following manner. P of 3 holds, that is n0 equals 3, and if P of k is holding, P of k plus 1 also will come out. Some more manipulations are needed to get this proof, that's all. Some more exercises are supplied, or examples are supplied. That is actually the next one is also important to remember all these things. That is 2 raised to n is going to be less than or equal to n plus 1 factorial. It also can be done with the PMI. And the proofs are available here. It is just a routine thing. For n equals 1, you have to do, okay, immediately it will come out and the proof is direct. Also, a well-known formula for us for geometric progression and all at that time, we have seen that. So this result is also can be proved with PMI. So even without PMI also, it's easy. 1 plus r plus etc. r raised to n is going to be 1 minus r raised to n plus 1 divided by 1 minus n. So I'm just leaving these examples. They are really vital examples. We need it later also to have a look at on these proofs. And more problems, the exercises are supplied in Bartle. One can use it and enjoy that. So how much powerful this tool, we have observed it already, PMI. Comes from the well ordering property also. Okay, this some notions, I mean some properties, some fundamental things about natural numbers are highly in need for us to understand what are integers and q and real numbers. The only relevant things we will review. So in the first lecture I was trying to give you, see n, if you are looking at, it is the first set which is not going to be a finite set. That was our observation. And we can actually define what is finite. So for the completeness, I will just restate such things. As a definition, I can repeat what I have already discussed in the first lecture. Empty set, you will write it as, or we will say that it is having zero elements. Moreover, the first section, I mean about 1, 2, 3, 4, if you are looking at up to n, the first n natural numbers, and if I am denoting the section as nn, and if you have a bijection 1 to 1 as well as onto, if I have a bijection, that is what's the meaning of the thing, a 1 to 1 as well as onto map to some set S, then we say that S has n elements. Obviously, why the definition comes is clear. Now, a set S is said to be finite if it is either an empty set or it has n elements for some n. That is, it's going to have a bijection with some sections of n natural numbers. Some sections, I mean the beginning section. 1, 2, 3, up to somewhere it stops. That is what the section I mean here. If I need section. So this is the definition for a finite set. Once you have the notion of finite, a set S is said to be infinite if it is not finite, which means you can't find a bijection with any n for n, small n. For any small n, you can't get like this. So what you are understanding, systematically analyzing all these things is that the first infinite set will meet with is going to be a natural number. That is, n we have written 1, 2, 3, 4, etc., etc. no NNs are going to be in bijection with this thing, which ideally says it is going to be the first infinite set in our experience. So N is going to be the first infinite set that you are going to look for. So infiniteness starts with natural numbers. In some sense, we can say that. That is the simplest model of infinity, which possesses infinite number of elements. Not infinity, infinite number of elements. You can actually say set is infinite, not the elements. Okay. So once these kind of notions are familiar with us, even one can look for what happens from n to raise to z. That is, while going to z, is these kind of things have changed? I mean, can you find a bijection with n or somewhere or bigger than that? So some more terminologies we have already described. So this is something like a denumerability. Now we will formally state that also. So before proving that, so many nice results one can have it. If you are having finite set and infinite set, a finite set cannot contain an infinite set inside. That is precisely this theorem says. If you are taking, see, S is, for example, any of the statements are, one is the contrapositive of the other. See, if you are having a finite set and T is sitting inside S, then T also should be finite. On the other hand, the contra side, if you are looking at, if T is an infinite set, then S is an infinite set. A finite set cannot possess an infinite set. So such things, one can prove it if you are sitting up with the logical way of, a systematic way of analyzing. And one can just recapture our definitions of countability and all. So that definition also, you'll use it from now onwards. So n is the first infinite set we are observing, as you have seen. A set S is said to be denumerable or countably infinite if there exists a bijection between N and S. That is what. That is a denumerability or countably infinity we mean. And also, a set we call that is a countable set, either it is a finite set or it's a denumerable set, which means C is countable means either it should be finite, even empty set you can have, or some it will be in bijection with some section, I mean NN, or it may be having a bijection with N. Such things are going to be called countable. So the definitions, we have to take it. So the next level is what? Finite sets are there, starting from empty set, and finite sets are there. Infinite set, we have seen some sets looking like natural numbers, which we are going to call countably infinite or denumerable. So after that, how can you increase the size? That is what is called uncountable. A set which is not countable is going to be called an uncountable set. So these definitions, you have to take it for granted, and we'll use it while moving along. Okay, we'll look at some more properties about this kind of sets. While moving from N to Z, Z to Q, Q to R, what happens on this kind of countability and all.